Now, Paul and company, as we've been reading through Acts, the last time we were in Acts just recently, Paul and company were in the city of Philippi. They have now left the city of Philippi, and they're making their way to Thessalonica. They had to first travel through the city of Amphipolis, which was a 33-mile trek from Philippi to there. And then from there, they went another 27 miles to Apollonia. And then from Apollonia, they traveled another 35 miles until they finally made their way to Thessalonica. But once again, as Paul and Silas enter into the city, he returns to his strategy of going to the synagogue on the Sabbath. As a matter of fact, he went three Sabbaths in a row. He reasoned with them, he showed them the scriptures in order to convince them that the Messiah must suffer and then rise from the dead. Why did he have to explain that to them? Well, you see, the Jews were under the impression that the Messiah would be this great military leader likened to King David of old. And they got a conqueror, but not a conqueror of peoples, not a conqueror of nations, but a conqueror over sin and death. You see, the crucifixion and resurrection were roadblocks for the Jews, stumbling blocks, because they could not conceive of that kind of shame being put on the Messiah. But that just tells us exactly how huge it was that God did what he did, because Jesus bore our shame and our sin on the cross on our behalf. But you could put it this way, that the crucifixion and resurrection were obstacles that needed to be navigated around. And so here's the thing. Everyone has something. Everyone has obstacles to overcome before they can be receptive to the gospel. Why did God allow that to happen to me? Why did God allow that to happen to this person that I dearly care for? And then, therefore, they think that God must not care about people. And if God exists, he must not care about people. And that's a huge obstacle for people to get around. Because the truth is, everyone has obstacles to overcome before they can be receptive to hearing the gospel. Never feel like, oh, this is huge. I don't know if I can do this by myself. You're not. You've got the church behind you. After all, where are we inviting people to come to? And what are we inviting people to come and see? We're introducing them to Jesus Christ and inviting them to become a part of the church, become a part of the family of God. But if we love Jesus and we love our church, let me ask you this last question. You have a heart for those who are lost. Then let us band together and as a unified church, go to the people in our lives and offer them those three simple words. Come and see. Let's pray. Lord Jesus,